Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. We are so excited that you've joined us for online worship at Webster Gardens. I'm Pastor Dave, and we just want to say happy Easter to you. Jesus has risen from the dead, and it's the reason that we worship. So grab those chocolate Easter bunnies or pastel colors or whatever you got at home, but let's worship our risen King Jesus.
Christ lay my death enshrouded. Christ lay my death enshrouded. Christ lay my death, my death, my death enshrouded. My death enshrouded.
From mortal sin
to save us. From mortal sin to save us.
Thank you. Yeah.
is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Welcome to church. You're at Webster Gardens. My name is Pastor Dave. We are so honored that you have joined us here for worship on this Easter Sunday. We've been talking about over this last week how Christ entered into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. He came with this triumphant entry. Maundy Thursday, he came and he showed up for his disciples and for the world. Friday, he came and he was broken on the cross for you and me. But here's the good news. Today's the day. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Let's sing.
Let's continue to hear this good news of Easter through our children's message, and I invite you to be seated. All right, time for a tour. No, not of the church grounds, of my station wagon. Let's check it out. Five-liter engine, pristine cloth seats, booming sound system.
Don't you remember you told me you loved me, baby?
And not one, not two, but zero cup holders.
But four ashtrays.
People on the street, they love this car. I get compliments on it all the time. Here's some more about it. Handle on my back tailgate is broken. It used to work, now it doesn't. Why? I don't know.
My air conditioning fan was broken. I got it fixed. Now it works. Well, the first two levels work. On the third level, it just shuts off. Better than nothing.
The side view mirror cable broke, so I can't turn it. I just have to adjust it by hand. Oh well.
Pretty sure that's not supposed to be like that.
The engine works. Great, right?
But it leaks oil. It's an old car.
What can you do? Seriously, what can you do? I'd love to know what you can do. Last week, I was driving on Big Bend and got a big thumbs up from some people in the car next to me. Right at that moment, smoke started coming out from under the hood. So all of those things, some of them I get fixed, and some of them I just say,
better than nothing.
Oh well.
Just how it is. And I know that eventually all of those things are gonna add up until it's not worth having this car anymore. I mean, every car goes to the junkyard someday. No, don't say that. Oh, wait a minute, that was me. I said that. They just get too broken. This whole season, we've been looking at how we're broken too. I could give you the tour of myself and show you the things that aren't working right. I don't show honor to the people around me. I don't love my neighbor as myself. But here's the amazing thing. This is the Easter message. God doesn't look at us and say,
better than nothing.
Oh well.
Just how it is. And then wait for us to go to the junkyard. Nope. On Good Friday, Jesus went to the grave, the junkyard, for broken old me and broken old you. And on Easter, he rose from the dead, and he promises us that in our baptisms, we share in that resurrection too. God won't leave us broken in our own sins. He died and rose for us. He restores us. So all of God's restored people say, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia.
In honor of our risen King, Jesus Christ, please stand for the reading of the gospel. This is the account of the resurrection of Jesus. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe. And they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the word of the Lord. Please join me as we celebrate this Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
Confessing our faith in this faithful God also leads us to come with a confession of our own sins and brokenness and our need for him. So would you pray with me now? Let's use these words that you see on the screen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
So the God who died, was crucified, and was buried showed his love for you on that cross. And the God who rose from the dead on Easter showed his power over sin and death, your sin and your death. So the good news of Easter is that Jesus' resurrection restores you into a right relationship with God, and you stand forgiven. And that's a status that is for today and is forever. Have his peace. Amen. Let's remain standing as we continue our worship.
Thank you.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
You may be seated. You know, Easter brings lots of emotions. Emotions of rejoicing. I mean, how beautiful has our music been through today and this Lenten season? Can we thank our choir and our musicians for this time? They're gonna hate that I did that during the sermon, all right? But seriously, thank you. Thank you for your work, because this day brings emotions of rejoicing. It also brings emotions of celebration. I mean, y'all look good today, right? You bring out the pastel-colored shirt, and you dress up a little bit nicer, and you gather together the family for some good food and some food that you probably shouldn't eat too much of. But hey, it's Easter, right? And tomorrow I can start a diet. Because Easter also brings emotions of accomplishment. For some of you, you gave up something like 40 plus days ago, and you're like, thank you, Jesus, that it is Easter, and now I get to look at social media and eat some chocolate again. Easter brings all kinds of emotions. But did you hear the emotion that came to the women who showed up on that Easter morning to the empty tomb? Look here in Mark chapter 16, it says this, that they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to no one. Not emotions of rejoicing and celebration and accomplishment, but these emotions of trembling and astonishment. I think these are beautiful words that need to be held together here today. Because what if I were to tell you that these two emotions are emotions that we too should be feeling today on this Easter morning? Because trembling and astonishment seize us when we experience God. Trembling and astonishment seize us when we experience God. Let me explain. There was this English philosopher by the name of Anthony Flew. He was a man who was incredibly brilliant, really smart, a philosopher, but he was also somebody who was an advocate for atheism. He did not believe that there was a God for most of his life. And Flew wasn't one of those like Facebook trolls that hid behind an anonymous like name or some kind of keyboard warrior. No, he was a guy who debated the greatest philosophers of the time. And then, in 2007, he shocked the world. He shocked the philosophy world. He wrote a book that was entitled this: There Is a God, How the World's Most Notorious Atheist Changed His Mind. Has anybody read this book by chance? Has anybody heard of this book? Oh, it's an interesting book to read of this journey that Anthony Flew comes to in believing that there has to be a God. And he raises this question in the book that is a question that you and I should ponder, and I believe that every human being should ponder as well. He says this in the book. He says in the book, I therefore put to my former fellow atheists the simple central question. What would have to occur or to have occurred to constitute for you a reason to at least consider the existence of a superior mind? Flew asks this question, and what he's really saying is this: what would have to occur in this world for you to think outside of yourself? For you to think outside of your plan? Because we as human beings, we like to have our plan put together. We want to have that good job with the good family, the 2.5 kids, and then, you know, have the good, like, retirement and kind of coast off later in life. But Flew says this: what would have to occur for you to think outside of yourself? I'm here to say today that something has happened that forces us to think outside of ourselves. And I think we see today, we experience God in three profound ways. They're all P words. I'd love for you to write them down somewhere here, all right? But in these, we see that we will experience, when we experience God, we will experience trembling and astonishment when we first experience God's power. A couple weeks ago, I was meeting with one of our church members. His name is John. I'm not making this up. This is his name. He's a scientist. He did his whole career. He was studied plants, and he worked for Bayer, and now he's retired. And we were sitting having a conversation about something else, and I said to John, I said, John, many people who are scientists don't believe in God, but you do. So how do you know that God exists? And he said, oh, Pastor, that's a really simple answer. One word: photosynthesis. I'm like, okay, I didn't expect that, but again, from somebody who studies plants, you know this like elementary thing, right, of where we as human beings produce carbon dioxide, and we are dependent upon plants to turn that carbon dioxide through this process known as photosynthesis, of that where it takes light and water and plants to then output oxygen. Have you ever thought about it before? How astonishing this is of how God created this world. Well, John followed up in that conversation. He wrote me in an email, and he said, I want to give you a little bit more context here. He said, the process of photosynthesis has been described as being deceptively simple. That's probably our first clue to the hand of God at work. You probably already know this, but this was news to me. Photosynthesis in green plants occurs in the chloroplasts, which are specialized organelles. The sunlight is absorbed by chlorophyll molecules. There are actually two types which absorb light at different wavelengths. There's a series of light reactions, photosystems 1 and 2, obviously, that produce a reducing agent in energy, and then a dark reaction cycle known as... No, it's the Calvin cycle. Come on. Jeez, to convert the CO2 to carbohydrate. He said this: I don't pretend to recall all the intricacies, but suffice it to say there was an entire chapter of my graduate biochemistry text devoted to photosynthesis. And he said this: and some researchers still spend their careers going even deeper. When we experience God's power, it leaves us with emotions of astonishment. Amen? This God spoke this into being, and we as human beings are taking our smartest people and plants, and they are spending their career to study how God made things to be. But when I hear that description, it also leaves me kind of in a place of trembling, right? I mean, we are fragile human beings. The fact that we are dependent upon plants to breathe seems rather fragile for us as people. And it becomes something that's fragile for us and leaves us trembling unless we know the one who put it into existence, the one who has power to place the stars in the sky, to create photosynthesis, and yes, even the one who has the ability to raise the dead. That's why in Mark chapter 16, it says this, in Mark 16, verse 6, it says this, and he, the angel, said to them, to the women, do not be alarmed, for you seek Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. God, speaking through these angels, says to the women, do not be alarmed. This God who has the power to create things that we study for our whole lives is the same God who has risen from the dead that we worship here today. And we will have these experiences, emotions of trembling and astonishment when we experience God's power, but also, secondly, when we experience God's promise. Did you hear this other statement that was said in verse 7 here? Mark tells us, but go, he says, tell his disciples, to the women, and Peter, that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. See, the God that we worship here today is not random. He holds his end of the bargain. He holds his promises. He had foretold that this was going to happen, that he would rise from the dead. And he did it. It's a display of his love and care for you and me, but it's a display of what he's come to do to bring salvation in this world, a love that is unlike any other love that we will experience. Pastor and author Tim Keller, he has this wonderful quote. It's one of my favorites of his. He says this, that speaking of the kind of love that God brings, he says, to be loved but not known is comforting but superficial. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear. But to be fully known and truly loved is, well, a lot like being loved by God. It is what we need more than anything. It liberates us from pretense, it humbles us out of self-righteousness, and it fortifies us for any difficulty life can throw at us. The love that God provides is astonishing. And what he has done and how he holds his end of the bargain. But also the love that God provides is one that can lead us with some trembling as well. Because God knows your deepest secret. God can see through the veneer that we often play out for people. God knows your greatest and deepest fears and anxieties. And God knows your greatest joys as well. And what's astonishing is that God chose to hold his end of the bargain, knowing who you and I are, and he has entered into this world to bring salvation to a broken world. Which leads to the third P, the final one here. That trembling and astonishment will seize us when we experience God's passion. See, over this season of Lent, we as a church have been doing this thing with these banners. Raise your hand if you've been noticing these banners that have been going on here. You're like, what in the world is happening, right? If you show, like, it began on Ash Wednesday or that first Sunday, we had the banners up there that looked like this on the screens, right? They were whole and you could see them. And then as the weeks went on, we were talking about how we are broken as people, right? We're torn, but it's not just that we are broken as people. We live in this broken world and we contribute to it, but we are also affected by it as well. Did anybody expect to see banners like this here today? What these banners represent is an ancient Japanese art known as kintsugi. It's a fun word to say. Why don't you say it with me? One, two, three. Kin. Kin means gold, and sugi means reconnect. It's a process that's used to take broken things and work through it to make beautiful things. It's like this cup or like these banners that were torn but are now whole. They're something beautiful. And just like this cup that's been kintsugied, what it is in one way, it restores its utility. This cup that was broken, like these banners that were broken, it restores it back to how it's supposed to be. But more than that, it's not just a repair process like how Brian has to take his car to the shop all the time. It's something that brings greater value. It restores and repairs and makes it more valuable than it was in the beginning. Church, I don't know if you can make these connections or not. I hope you can. But Jesus Christ, on Easter Sunday, entered into this world, came out of the tomb, and he rose again for you and me. For a broken person, for a broken people, for a broken world, and he kintsugied it, but he repaired it, he restored it, he made it more beautiful, that because of his resurrection, there is hope, because of his resurrection, there is new life, and because of his resurrection, right now we experience it, and we await for him to come back to make it all whole and perfect again. Somebody say amen to this. And so trembling and astonishment, we will experience when we experience God's power, God's promise, and God's passion. And my prayer would be that you would join us in this journey. That's who we are as a church. We see these three things, his power, his promise, and his passion all on this Easter Sunday. But it's not just for Easter Sunday. It's something that motivates us. It's something that shapes us. It shapes the way that we look at ourselves. It shapes the way that we look at each other. And it shapes the way that we live in this world. And I would invite you to join us. Join us in this journey again. Because to go to Anthony Flew's question, what would have to occur or to have occurred to constitute for you a reason to at least consider the existence of a superior mind? My answer would simply be this. Jesus Christ would have to raise from the dead. And he has. And so it leaves us with these emotions of, yes, trembling because Jesus is who he says that he is, but it leaves us also with astonishment as well in his power and his promise and in his passion. This is why today's a really big deal, but it's also why we worship. Christ is risen. Let's pray. Thanks, God, for your resurrection. It is the reason that we can come here in this broken world and worship you. Thanks, Jesus, for the promise that you bring. Thanks for displaying your power. And thank you, Lord, for the passion, the depth of what you have done for this world. Help us, Lord, to be people who hold firmly to that truth, that with all of the emotions that we experience, Jesus, you have risen from the dead. And so we worship you. We look to you in all guidance and wisdom, and we pray the way that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One of the amazing ways that we also get to experience this gift of new life that has come through Jesus is through this meal, the Lord's Supper. And so a couple questions for you as we contemplate and prepare for this meal. Do you believe that Jesus is who he says that he is? That he is the one who came into this world, lived the perfect life that we could not live, died on a cross, and rose again for you? And do you believe that Jesus is present in this meal, that we take him at his word when he says that this is my body and this is my blood? We acknowledge a holy mystery that is happening here in this place. But we practice this meal in this way because Jesus instructed us to do so. If you believe these things to be true, then say, yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
I invite you to participate in this meal with us here today. If you're unsure of who Jesus is and what he's done for you, or unsure of why we practice this meal here at Webster Gardens and in the way that we practice it, I invite you to still come forward and cross your arms, and we would love to give you a blessing here today. See, it was on the night that Jesus was betrayed that he took some bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, Jesus then took the cup, and after taking a drink, he blessed it and gave it to them and said, "Take and drink. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you.
Thank you.
Jesus' presence has been for our souls, their highest good. Now may this, the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you and preserve you, keep you strong in a faith that trusts in him and his restoring love for life now and life everlasting. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen.
Hey, when you came in this morning, yesterday we had our Easter extravaganza where we give away, you know, eggs with candy and prizes in them. And on Easter Sunday, we give away a card. And you probably received one of these or will receive one of these. Make sure that you grab one. On the back side, you're going to see many areas of ministry that go on here at Webster Gardens. And we hope that you'll connect with this in some way. You know, as I looked at this, I noticed a quirky imperfection that was my fault. If you look and see where it says middle school students of the week, that date should be the exact same as the Scuba Vacation Bible School dates, June 17th through 21st. So why don't you kintsugi your card and you cross out the one where it says the week and you put that June 17th through 21st. But hey, it's those quirky imperfections that make this a collector's item. And it's also probably the reason you're actually looking at it right now. So you could even call that purposeful, but we really hope that you'll use this to find a way to get connected here at Webster Gardens. One thing that I hope that you've recognized today is the generosity of our God. Our risen God is truly a generous God, and he cares for each one of you here. And then that restoring love of God extends from this place out into our community, because we really believe that God has placed us here in this area, in this community, for his purpose. And so today we want to bring God's generosity to our community in a special way on your behalf. And so here's a way I want to invite you to do this. We want all of you worshiping today, members and guests, let us know that you've been here. You can do that by scanning the QR code on this card, or some of you have checked in on our app or want to go on our app, and you'll notice there's a little bit of a different process today. It's really the same for everyone. And everyone gets the same check-in. The reason for that is we want to make a special impact in our community today. So when you put in some check-in info from that QR code or on our app, an opportunity is going to come up for you to choose an organization that we have the honor of partnering with. And those charities are a picture of God's restoring care for the community around us. And so we'll make a donation on behalf of the charity that you choose that comes up there. That's a small way that we can make an impact in our community and also say thank you to you for spending this morning with us in worship. We also bring our offerings today as we connect with God's mission so more people experience that power of Jesus' restoration through his resurrection. And you can see on our screen different ways that our members connect with our offerings. As we close in worship, I want to invite you to stand up at this time. I want to let you know that next week, we welcome you here. We're going to be starting a new series as we're going to peel back what it looks like to cultivate the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, the way that God does that in our lives. It doesn't only change our lives, but when the fruit of God's Spirit is working in us and in this worship community, it also works out in our community and our world. And so our new sermon series is going to be called Peeled, Cultivating What's Underneath. And maybe you've felt like you wanted to explore God's Word a little bit more. We'll be looking in the New Testament book of Galatians and some other areas in Scripture as God reveals the fruit of his Spirit to us and in our lives. And now as you go, why don't you extend your hands? Because our generous God gives us the gift of his Son Jesus. It's encapsulated in this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.